Hello friends, so today we are going to learn about chapter 3, properties of natural resources. Basically there are many natural resources, so we deal with it one by one. So the first is air. Air is, you know, everywhere around us. We cannot see it, but we feel it forever, like when the wind blows. Feel air. Okay, when we inhale, we take in air. When we exhale, we take the air out. Air is everywhere on earth, naturally. So, what the first experiment is, basically you take balloons, two balloons and a stick. Okay, the stick can be a plastic stick or a metal stick or whatever is good. So, basically what you do is take a stick, hang it. This is rope, and let me change the color. This is say stick, so actually it should be more like equal. You should be hanging equal side. This is rope and this is say stick. Okay, the stick has to be arranged in such a manner that it is perfectly horizontal. Okay, so and then you tie two balloons. Remember, they both should be deflated, that is, there should be no air inside them. And when they attached, the stick should stay constant, the stick shouldn't move. Okay, and then inflate one of the balloons. So, as you inflate the balloon, the one you see in figure 3.1, the balloon with the air goes down. So naturally, if you remember the case of swing, even in swing the one with heavier side goes down. Okay, so also, so this proves that the one with air is heavier, and thus air has mass and weight. This was what you want to prove in the experiment. Okay, now second thing is, take an injection syringe without the needle. Okay, remember, without the needle. And then basically what you have to do is, you have to pull out the piston. This can be done easily, not an issue. And even if you leave it, it is there. However, when you try to pull it in, just a moment, when you try to push it, then it is not that easy. Why? We will see. Okay, so as it is written, the piston then remains in that position even if you let it go. Now, close the inlet of the syringe tightly with your thumb, pull the piston and let it go. Then in the last paragraph, the one on the top, on pulling the piston, the inlet hole of the syringe closed. More space becomes available to the air and it becomes rarefied. As a result, the air pressure in the syringe is lower. Comparatively, the pressure of the outside air is very high. That is why when the pulled piston is released, it immediately pushed in it. Okay? So, for different positions, if you try it, the results will be same. Not much different. So, from this, we can say, atmospheric pressure is same in all the directions. Okay, so basically this is one of the things you should know, that under ordinary conditions, atmospheric pressure at sea level is about 1,1400 newtons per square meter. As we decrease, atmospheric pressure reduces. That is, the pressure in, say, Thiruvananthapuram will be much higher than the pressure in, say, Srinagar. Okay, so great scientist Daniel Bernoulli, he proposed Bernoulli theorem, which is basically how it goes. So what he said, that the pressure of air decreases when its velocity increases, while pressure of air increases when its velocity decreases. basically the pressure and velocity are inversely proportional to each other. He proposed that. And as you will learn in later classes, that it actually affects the way we understand most of the fluids. Okay, so the third experiment is, we take some water in a plastic cup. Basically, I have to explain in short. This is a glass of water. This is another straw. This is the first straw. So what you do is, you blow the air into it. So what happens is, as the air is displaced, the water rushes to take its position. Okay? And as the water rushes, it creates a fountain-like structure. Okay? So as it is written, on blowing through the straw, the air at its open end is pushed away, and hence pressure on the air at opening goes down. Remember Bernoulli theorem? High pressure is obtained at lower velocities. Basically this. Okay, due to Bernoulli theorem, the pressure reduces. As the pressure of air near the upper end of the straw becomes less than the atmospheric pressure, the water in the cup is pushed from where the atmospheric pressure is higher here to where the atmospheric pressure is lower here. The more forcefully you blow, the higher will be the fountain. Straw fountain works on Bernoulli's principle. Okay. Now here is why the wind blows. When there is a temperature difference in air pressure at two different places, the air starts flowing from place of high pressure to place of lower pressure. Okay? If I give an example, air pressure is high and air pressure is low. So the air flows from area of higher pressure to place of lower pressure. Basically to equalize the pressure as much as possible. After the air flows, maybe the temperature can be this. However, if that happens, you will feel a one-time wind and it won't blow. Generally, this pressure is maintained through various atmospheric conditions, which you will learn later. Or maybe you have already learned about breezes. Okay? At such times, we feel a breeze or wind blowing. Thus, winds are an effect of the differences in air pressure. Okay? You will learn that when you do that in geography. Okay, now take the fourth experiment is, this is very easily done, you can even try it at your home, but yeah, take less ice cubes. So basically, take a glass, any glass, although in glass it will be easily visible, but yeah, even metal will do. Take a metal glass, put some ice cubes in it, and just wait. What will happen is, after not more than 5 minutes, you will see some water outside the glass. Why? We see. Due to ice cube, I'm reading this part. Due to the ice cubes in glass, the air surrounding the glass cools down. Getting it? Because of ice, the air is cooled. As the water vapor in the air cools down, it condenses and gets transformed into water. It is this water that is collected on the outer surface of the glass. Now, that actually really depends. When there is hot summers like May or June, then it will take a lot of time because the moisture in the air is low. But in monsoons, that won't be much of an issue. So, the level of humidity is different in different places. Similarly, the humidity levels also change from time to time during the period of single day, as I explained. Humidity, where it rains often, is very, very high. For example, in the Western Ghats, where it rains really often, it's characterized by its humid climate. But in other places where it is dry, it takes little time. The level of humidity of the air is determined by its capacity to hold water vapor. How much, basically, you know, air is not just one thing. It's a lot of gases mixed into one. One of the gases, water vapor. Typically, air has 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and remaining other particles. Water vapors constitute a very small portion of this. However, even small difference is good enough to be felt by us. So, the level of humidity of air is determined by its capacity to hold water vapor. At lower temperature, the water cannot be held. Okay? At such time, excess water is transformed into droplets. This is what we called dew. In the afternoon, when the temperature of the air is high, the capacity of the air to hold moisture also increases. Then, compared to its full capacity to hold water, the proportion of moisture in air is less and we feel that air is dry. Monsoon, the same humidity, it is the case. Okay, now as we go, we see that, as I said, air is not a homogeneous mixture. I mean, air is a homogeneous mixture, I'm sorry, but air is not one thing, it's multiple things. So, as I mentioned, air is a mixture of very fine particles of some gases, dust, smoke, and moisture. When rays of light fall on these minute particles, the particles spread the light in all directions. This phenomenon is called scattering of light. Okay, basically, I'll give an example. This is a particle. Okay. And here comes the light. It collides with it. So, what happens is, as the particle collide, it spreads the lights in all directions. Maybe homogeneous in all direction, or maybe in one particular direction. Generally, it spreads equally in all direction. Okay, this phenomenon is what we call scattering of light. Now, temperature regulation. Okay, now this is our Earth. This is the sun, and this, although ideally should be colorless as possible, but yeah, I can't really help it or it won't be visible. Okay, screw that. And this is the atmosphere. So what happens is, as the sunlight reaches the Earth, some of the heat is trapped in this atmosphere. Okay. The atmosphere traps some of this heat. So even this part remains warm. This is basically what they're trying to explain. The Earth receives energy from the sun. This energy is reflected by the Earth in the form of heat. Some is reflected, but bulk of it is absorbed. The constituents of air surrounding the Earth, such as water vapor, carbon dioxide, absorb a part of this heat and give it to the constituents of air. Okay, as a result, the Earth's surface remains warm and becomes suitable for the living world on Earth. Okay, I'll give you a basic idea. Mercury is the closest planet to the sun. It has no atmosphere, or even if it has one, it is really thin. So what happens is, the side facing the sun is burning hot and the side away from the sun is freezingly cold. So what happens is, if Earth did not have that atmosphere, the average temperature on the Earth, as they say, would have been very low. And life wouldn't be able to thrive. I mean, the life as we know it. Transmission of sound. As we know, sound requires a medium. Because sound requires particles to propagate. So hence, all the sounds that we hear reaches through the surrounding air. Okay, now one thing is, the density of air also changes due to the change in temperature. In winter, the density of air increases. So hence, the air, you can hear sounds better in winter than in summer. Though human ears can't make much of a difference between the two. Next come property. Properties of water. I'm sorry. So basically, as we see, what they want to show is, or as you might be knowing, is that the water does not have a shape. This is what is written. Water does not have its own shape, but has a volume. Okay, it can pass through small holes or seep through very small gaps or cracks. Okay. On pouring water in an oil-clad dish, water does not spread, but forms small oil round drops. Why does this happen? Okay, this happens because oil and water, if I have to define in one term, they dislike each other. Okay, so water needs a conducive surface to spread. If it does not allow to spread, it basically forms a droplet to minimize the area between the two. If you don't like someone, you try to spend as less time as them with that is possible. Hence, both oil and water, they don't like each other. There's a technical term for that. Oil is called hydrophobic. Hydro, water, phobic, fear. Okay. So basically, oil and water, they don't get along quite well. Hence, to minimize the area, water forms a droplet. This minimizes area and allows the two to coexist. Okay, basically what this experiment is, try this. Take a plastic bottle, half full of water. Okay, this is not a plastic bottle maybe. Let me change, try some different thing. Take a plastic bottle. Okay, I hope this is the only thing you would have to do in terms of bottle now. Half full with water. Okay, this is water. Half full with water. Mark the water level on the bottle. Right now it is here. Keep this bottle upright in the freezer for making ice. Open the freezer after a couple of hours and observe. You will see that water has changed into ice. Now one thing is, the ice will have a lower temperature than water. Water was still here, ice will be still here. Okay, maybe not that pronounced difference, but it will be lesser. Okay, I did the same mistake as most of us would do. What happens is, in most of the liquids, as they freeze, they tend to be consolidated. But again, water behaves very differently. Okay? This is what we will learn in detail. As water freezes to form ice, it expands and its volume increases. Okay? On freezing, how much was increasing volume of water? Now, this is an exception we will study. Water is actually an exception to the rule. As a matter of fact, in most of the liquids, the solid phase has lesser volume than the liquid phase. Except water. So don't do that mistake I did. Okay. Now two, basically take a water and drop some random articles in it and make a list that float or not. And the third part is take some water and add few pieces of ice. You will see that ice floats on water. Okay. But okay. For a thing to float on water, it has to be lighter than water. Okay, this proves that ice is lighter than water. Okay, as it is written, ice is lighter than water. When the water freezes to form ice, it becomes lighter than the original liquid. When water freezes, that is, transforms into the solid state, its volume increases. This is why the density of ice is less than the density of water. Okay, let's explain density first. It will be easy to explain. Okay, density is equals to mass upon volume. Now remember, the mass, the amount of water you are depositing will remain same. Mass, if I have to write, is constant, then what depends is volume. Now, what happens is, as the as the volume increases and ice forms water, the density of ice decreases. Okay. Now comes anomalous property of water. As I already described, usually when the temperature of a substance is lowered, its density increases as the volume decreases. But water is an exception to this rule. As I said. So usually, so let's do an experiment. Take a glass, fill it with water. This time preferably made of glass. Keep it in freezer for 5 to 10 minutes. You see that, you will see that the water starts freezing from up and then gradually goes down. Okay. So as they say, the density of water is peculiar. When the water at normal temperature starts cooling, its density increases like that of other liquids. Okay, as we know. However, if the temperature falls below 4 degrees Celsius, the density starts decreasing. Okay, this is where the anomaly starts. This means that the density of water is maximum at 4 degrees Celsius. The moment you go below 4 degrees Celsius, the density decreases. It means that water expands when temperature falls below 4 degrees Celsius. This is called anomalous behavior of water. It is not yet known why water has such separate properties. But due to this property, life can survive. Because if other like other liquids, this is an example of a lake. If the entire water was frozen, the entire marine life would have been killed. But thanks to this property of water, this does not happen. And marine life continues to thrive below the frozen shore. So, try this. Basically, this is an experiment that tells about the density of water. Okay, first you take plain water, pour a potato into it, then add tons of salt to the second water, and then add a potato to it. The potato will start to float. Why? Because, as it is put, the density of water in the glass is greater due to the dissolved salt. This means that here it's a lot of salt. Here it's plain water particles, the potato goes down easily. But here the salt occupies a lot of space and allows the potato to float. Okay? Now, in fact, there is a lake which is called Dead Sea. It's somewhere in the Middle East, you can Google that. In Dead Sea, the salt is so much that even humans float on that lake. Okay? When the salt, the salt disappears. So where it disappears? I'm reading this line. Basically, this. When the salt dissolves in water, its particles spread in water. Slowly they become smaller and smaller. Ultimately, they become so small that they cannot be seen. Basically, this is a salt particle. Okay, maybe I should use different color for that. This is a salt particle. And this is water. These are water particles. So what happens is these water particles attack on all sides and try to break it. So the salt goes smaller, unless it completely disappears. Okay? This is what is called dissolving. So what is solute? The substance that dissolves. Salt, solvent, the substance in which solute dissolves. Here it is water. Solution, is solute plus solvent gives solution. Okay, the uses of water. One is used for water transport, naturally. Water falling from a height is used to generate electricity with the help of generator. This you will learn when you study about electricity generation. Water is a good coolant and is used in motor vehicles to control the temperature of engine. Basically, what happens is that, for example, the engine in industries, there are large machines. The machines tend to get very, very hot. So what you do is you take some cold water and naturally separate it from the electric machine. And then as the water goes around the machine, it absorbs the heat and this water is then thrown out. Or rather, we try it. Nowadays, it is cooled down and reused. This is what is why water is a good coolant. Many substances are soluble in water. Water is a universal solvent. Okay. This fourth point we know is used for cleaning purposes, for bathing, washing clothes, etc. Now, come to soil. What is the properties of soil? Color is an important property of soil. Remember, the soil found in the northern plains, alluvial soil, and the soil found in maybe old places like Maharashtra is really, really different. Okay? Because I don't know if you have learned in your geography class, or maybe you will learn that the northern plains, the Ganga Yamuna Delta, they have been formed much later than the parts below the Vindhya ranges. Okay, you will learn about that. But basically, soil depends. Okay, the soil gets its color as a part of several processes. The soil near land surface is darker than the color at the lower layer. Soil may be of different colors such as black, red, copper, yellow, gray. To be honest, I've never seen such variety of soil till now. Okay, the colors of soil are useful for classification. For example, there is black soil, there is red soil, there is alluvial soil. This is more of a geographical content than science though. Okay. Besides, they are indirectly useful in indicating several properties of land. Okay, for example, alluvial soil is useful when you have to grow wheat and rice. The red soil is really useful when you have to grow cotton. So yeah, properties of land can be indicated by soil. So just an example, you can even predict the flora and the fauna that will flourish because of that. In this way, the properties of the soil, such as fertility, drainage of water, capacity to hold water, become clear from its color. The color of the soil depends upon its texture and its organic ingredients, as well as the chemical ingredients like iron, lime, etc. Now, some soil are rich in iron. Some amount of iron is beneficial for the plants. You will learn about that when you go to higher classes. Okay. Basically, one thing is the texture. It's coarse, it's fine, okay, and it's organic ingredients. Now, this is what makes a difference. The alluvial soil of the northern plains is formed by the silt coming from the Ganga and Yamuna river above. The soil in Maharashtra is formed by the years, since I've said Maharashtra is older. So they have a lot more organic ingredients because the old life, it's still underground. It has more organic ingredients and it's really different. As well as on chemical ingredients like iron and lime. This I cannot give an example of because it's not really well known. Okay, try this. Apparatus, 3 measuring cylinder, 3 glass funnels, filter paper, water. Now this is what? Fine sand, coarse sand, soil from an earthen pot, used for growing plants, etc. Okay? So, what you do is, you must be knowing on how to roll a filter paper. If you don't know that, no issues. You will learn about that. basically what happens is sand, sandy soil and clay. Okay, so clay, this particular thing, it can hold water really, really well. So whenever you want a thing to hold water, just use clay. But mind it, the plants may not survive that well, because as I explained in chapter maybe one or two, the roots need to breathe. So the plants that grow in clayey soil have evolved different mechanism to grow. Okay, so as I say, clay is holds well very good. So C is in clayey soil. Okay, A, sand. Sand does cannot hold water. So this is sand. And since sand and clay have been covered, this is in case of sandy soil between the two. Okay, now coming back to soil texture. Soil contains particle of different sizes. Okay, basically size can be different. There can be rocks, there can be not rocks, maybe rocks is incorrect term, pebbles or soil particles. Now what is it? The texture of the soil is determined by the proportion of particles of various sizes in it. This is the point to be noted. Following are the types of soils on the basis of texture. 1. Sandy soil. Now straight go to Rajasthan. The proportion of sand, that is large particles, is high in sandy soil. Okay, basically let me give an idea. These are two large particles. You try to pass water through it, the water passes easily. Okay. The properties of sand, that is large particle, is high in sandy soil. Water drains rapidly through sandy soil. It is easy to plow the soil. Why? Because the particles are large, the plow will pass easily. But it is less fertile. Why? This is because the particle of sandy soils are made up of a mineral called silicon dioxide, quartz. This is an issue. You know, silicon dioxide nowadays has a different purpose. All of the electrical components we use are derived from it. Okay, but the point being, it's not fertile to support any life. These particles do not dissolve in water, and therefore soil has very little capacity to supply nutrients. You cannot grow crops in sandy soil. Okay. Second, still soil. Basically, I can't give an example to it. There is medium, okay? If for sand it was this big, for stilt it's this big. Okay, maybe not this kind of gap, but even if this has a gap, the water that passed easily through this is stored by this, then this, then water this by this. This is a sandy, the water has no control. The particles of stilts are of medium size. Soil is not as ployable as sandy soil. Again, particles are small. The plow takes much pressure to separate and break the particles. However, it is much more ployable than clay soil. Clay soil, we'll see. The soil contains a large portion of organic material. Its capacity to supply nutrients is much greater. Stilt soil is also called sedimentary soil. This is the term which is more widely used. Sedimentary soil. Now what is clay? In clay, the particles are like this. Very small particles arranged really, just a moment. If I have to explain it, very small particles like this. Basically the particles are really, really, really fine. And they are very closely arranged. Try to flow water, water is entrapped. Okay. The proportion of small particles is maximum. The particles of clay feels free to touch. Clay soil has a high water holding capacity. you want to grow rice, you want the soil that can hold water. Okay? Soil structure. The structure of the soil depends upon the shape of the particles in it. Soil occurs in the form of columnar. Column, we define this is sort of columnar. Columns. Laminar. Lamina is basically a sheet. Laminar is a sheet of that. So this is what you call laminar structure. Basically one sheet atop of other, one sheet atop of other, one sheet another. A sheet like structure basically. Granular. You know grains, right? If you have ever seen a wheat grain, it's small, it's spread out. This is what is granular, like grains, fine. This is the photo corresponding photograph, as well as block shaped. This is mainly found in the hilly portions. Okay. Importance of soil structure. The fertility of soil depends upon soil structure. Yeah, as I said, sedimentary soil has the capability to support life than compared to sandy soil. Advantages of good soil are, 1. Roots get a sufficient supply of oxygen. 2. Water drainage is good. Remember, roots must get oxygen. Else, your whole plant is of no use if roots don't get oxygen. Now, what is the uses of soil? This is to cover up, to help plants grow. 2. Water conservation, to hold water. 3. Plasticity. Basically, soil can be given any shape. And then you can give the shape to form many other things. Some useful type of soil, China clay. White in color, is used to make crockery, mainly crockery. 2. Shadu soil. Whitish in color and used for making statues and ideals. Terracotta soil. Red in color and used for making decorative articles and pots. Terracotta soil is really good. You must see the soil once. This is really good. The articles made from it are really good. 4. Multani soil. This is used in cosmetics. To give you a bit of extra knowledge, Multani comes from a place in Pakistan which is called Multan. Hence the term Multani soil. Okay. So that box. China clay is an industrial mineral of type kaolinite. It is found in China and hence the name China clay. This is one thing. Upon heating, the soil acquires a glaze and hardness. It is therefore used for making crockery. Some of the good and expensive crockery is made using China clay. Now, what is soil testing? Now, okay, let me give a concept of this called pH. Here it is. It's already given in the box. So what happens is, the Danish scientist Sorensen put forth the concept of pH based on the concentration of hydrogen ions, basically H+. Okay, to determine the pH of a soil, a mixture of water and soil is taken in proportion of 1:2. Basically, if I have to explain in terms of glass, 1 glass water and then 2 glass soil. And tested using several indicators. Indicators are one which can tell you whether the soil is, not whether the soil, whether anything is acidic or basic. One of them is turmeric, also called haldi. You can Google it up. Haldi is a really good indicator for acids. Accordingly, soil may be found to be one of the 3 types. Acidic soil, which pH higher than 6.5. To give you an idea, distilled water has a pH of 7. Okay? Acidic soil, pH less than 6.5. Neutral soil, pH between 6.5 and 7.5. And alkaline soil, pH higher than 7.5. Okay? So, as we come back to soil testing, the properties of various ingredients of soil can be determined by soil testing. Now, what happens? During soil testing, the soil is examined for color, texture, and proportion of organic matter in it. Soil is tested. This is really important for farmers. Soil is tested to find out if there is a deficiency of any ingredient and to decide what measure should be taken to remove the deficiency. When plants are deficient and the soil is deficient, plants are also nutritive deficient and they do not grow as well as we want them to. So ideally, whenever a cultivating season is start, the farmers should have a soil test done so that they know what nutrients are absent in soil and how to replace it. Okay, the soil sample collected for testing is dried in an open space in the shade for 8 to 10 days. It is then shifted through a sieve. Two tests, namely pH and electrical conductivity test, are particularly useful in finding out the characteristics. Okay. Now, cause of soil fertility. Soil pH less than 6 or higher than 8. Some of the soils are by default acidic or basic, but they are rare enough in nature. 2. Low proportion of organic matter. This is an issue. Low organic matter means low fertility. 3. No proper drainage of water. Again, when water cannot be drained properly, the roots cannot survive. 4. Repeated cultivation of same crops. Now, if same crops are grown again and again and again and again, is, for example, if I take a crop X, say it takes a lot of iron from the soil. So when I take the iron, the iron is depleted. It's almost finished. It's depleted. You cannot grow that crop anymore. Try growing a different crop. 5. Continuous use of saline water. This is not really done though. 6. Excessive use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides. You must remember about Green Revolution, right? You must have learned about that. Okay? If you don't know, just Google it. What happened is, after Green Revolution, during Green Revolutions, a lot of fertilizers and pesticides were used. The yield was good. Really good. For 4 to 5 years, the yield was really, really good and we had no issues with that. But after 4 to 5 years later, because of so much pesticides and insecticides, the soil of Punjab, some part of it has become so barren that it cannot support life. So the soil has to be left fallow. Basically, you have to leave the soil for some, say, 7 to 8 years so that it can replenish itself. So as the box, soil texture is disturbed if chemical fertilizers are used excessively and that land becomes unsuitable for sowing. As I said, Punjab. Crops should be rotated in order to maintain the fertility of land. This is actually a type of cultivation. Okay? For example, the fertility of land decreases after a harvesting of wheat. Hence, leguminous crops like peanut, moong, moth bean, pea, lentil, Bengal gram, soya bean should be cultivated to restore the fertility of soil. Okay? So, thank you.